Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to our next session. Let me just recap quickly as to what we did last time. We started with programmable peripheral interface or programmable peripheral adapter, and we found out that interface and adapter in microprocessor domain here in this peripheral thing is one and the same. However, the meaning of adapter and meaning of interface is slightly different in a literal sense, but in microprocessor jargon, microprocessor area, particularly with respect to peripheral, both these terms, interface and adapter, are one and the same. That's why programmable peripheral interface, in short PPI, or programmable peripheral adapter, in short PPA, are equivalent terms with each other. We also saw that there are a variety of interfaces available, and a particular family interface should be selected after selecting a microprocessor while you start designing a complete microprocessor system. Customary to use any other family than microprocessor's family of chip to be selected for peripheral, we saw that. Of course, it's not very difficult as well. Somebody can have a specific design circuit for that, but that is additional burden, plus speed also matters. And that's why customary idea is to select PPI from the same family as that of a microprocessor. Intel is the biggest manufacturer of all, and that's why 8085, which is Intel product, is often coupled with peripherals from Intel belonging to TTL family. And all these ICs, they start with the first digit 8 as a number. For example, 8255. For example, 8085. For example, 8212. For example, 8279. For example, 8251. For example, 8259. All these chips are from Intel. Other manufacturers like Zilog and Motorola use different terminologies. Motorola prefers 68 series, 6800, 6809, 68000, 68 4 times 0, etc., etc. Zilog prefers a character Z, for example Z80, for example Z86, for example Z88, etc. So we are focusing on to Intel family, and other chips are also equivalent. It is something like, once we study PPI 8255, equivalent chip from Motorola or Zilog can be found out. They will immediately be found out to work in same coherence with this particular 8255, and system could be designed. As per our syllabus, we are to discuss only Intel family 8 series, and that's why we are focusing on 8085 microprocessor and 8 series peripherals. What all chips we are going to study? The most important chips are 8255, what we are studying right now, 8251, 8259, and 8279. These 4 important peripheral chips we are going to study, and we have started with 8255, and somewhere mid part of this discussion we are right now. So last time we saw all these things. We also saw that 8255 has 3 ports A, B, and C, and they are grouped into 2 groups, group A and group B. Group A consists of port A and upper 4 lines of port C. Group B consists of port B and lower 4 lines of port C. you can have three different modes of 8255 operation: mode 0, mode 1, and mode 2. And in mode 0, it is a simple IO port. Port A can be used as input or output. Port B can be used as input or output. Port C can also be used as input or output. In mode 1, we call it as a strobed IO mode. And for that strobed IO mode, we also saw that only port A and port B can be configured. Port C separately cannot be configured for mode 1 because this port C gets divided into two, C upper of 4 bits and C lower of 4 bits. C upper gets coupled with port A, C lower 4 bits get coupled with port B, and we have two distinct groups working as a peripheral ports for input or output devices, and these mechanism of input, we are calling it as a strobed IO. In third mode, that is mode 2, we saw that only port A can be configured. Port B or port C cannot be configured in mode 1. Port A only can be configured in mode 1, and with port A, all pins of C will get attached, and this becomes strobed bidirectional IO. This particular mechanism of mode 2 is very important when we are connecting active input device or active output device. What does that mean? Certain devices like keyboard, mouse, keypad, LED, simple switches, they all are singular, either input or output. Keyboard, mouse, key switch, they all are input devices. And monitor, LED, 7-segment readout, printer, they all are output devices. So, in mode 1 and mode 0, you are connecting specific devices which are either input device or output device. That's all. But in strobed bidirectional IO mode, that is mode 2, you can connect active device which can work at times as input or which can also work at time as output. The best example is your mobile touch screen. In your mobile touch screen, you have output being flashed by a mobile, and on that, by touching respective icons, you are submitting input as well. So, sometimes device works as input device, sometimes the same device works as output device, and this is active input output device, we call it as. The suitable example we saw is computer A connected with computer B. These computers work with each other as input or output devices respectively. Your hard disk interface. Hard disk interface is also IO, input output, because to hard disk you can write, from hard disk you can read. So in view of microprocessor, hard disk can work as an input device or hard disk can also be working as an output device. And that's why mode 2 has certain importance. I think logically, scientifically, up to this location we have seen very clearly, and I'm sure you must have understood. But before I progress further, let me see architecture of 8255. See, last time I told you, when you want to study a peripheral, what exactly you do? You study functionality of that port, then you study internal architecture of that port, you study programming of that particular port, and then you go for applying, that is applications of that particular port. You physically see how electronic circuit is connected or can be connected, and you physically write a program for handling these peripherals by a microprocessor. And A peripheral program is in two modes, one initializing that port and later using that port for data communication. While you are initializing a port, you simply instruct that port to behave in a particular fashion. For example, in 8255, which mode you are operating that 8255 in? Is it mode 0 or 1 or 2? You want to decide it, you need to decide it, and you do decide it by initializing 8255. Similarly, port A, is it input device or output device physically connected? Port B, is it input device or output device physically connected? Port C, is it input device or output device physically connected? That you need to decide. So, initializing a port means telling port as to what mode it is working in and which port is input or output device. That you need to define very clearly. That you do so by creating hexadecimal number called controlled word, sending that controlled word to a command register inside 8255 and keeping it there all the time. Example, your computer has one or more 8255s available. When you switch on your computer, what happens? By default, 8255 gets initialized as mode 0 and all input ports. But later, when your program starts, one of the port becomes output port, one of the port becomes input port, depending upon what connections you have done to what port. If you have connected your keyboard to a particular port, and if computer memory knows that this is the port to which keyboard has been connected, then it is bound to be initialized as input port. If you have connected a printer to your computer, then computer memory is bound to tell microprocessor to initialize that port as an output port. By default, when power is given to 8255, all ports are input port and it is in mode 0 operation. But as you progress, as your software starts getting executed to next level and next level, the initializing programs are there inside memory. They will be executed by microprocessor and ports will be set accordingly. This is a must. And this initialization is a simple phenomena for 8255. What are the steps for initialization program? Writing initialization program for 8255 means three steps. First, create a controlled word. How to create? We'll see with example. Second step, store that controlled word in accumulator and execute a command, move a comma port. If it is memory mapped IO, or out port if it is IO mapped IO, depending upon what hardware is there in front of you, how system has been designed, you need to either write instruction move a comma port comma a, or you need to write out port. You need to do that. So, second step is sending this word. Third, select that chip that is 8255 through chip select and select command register inside that PPI. So, once your command word, what you have created by looking at the electronic circuit you have, and once it is stored in accumulator A, and once it is passed towards the port whatsoever selected, and once it is written in command register of that 8255, thereafterwards 8255 will continue to behave like that, and it will continue to do so till power is available to 8255 and you have not overwritten anything onto that command register next. That means 8255 remembers as to what mode and what command it was set for by a microprocessor. And it will continue to remember until it is overwritten by a microprocessor or power goes off. Once power goes off, control register contents will be washed off. And when power resumes, the command register by default will develop that number, that hexadecimal number or binary number, which will make 8255 as mode 0 and all ports as input ports. So, after power is switched off and switched on next, you are required to initialize 8255 once again. Otherwise, it will not come back to the same state as it was. This is a simple step of initialization program. Once initialization program is over, you can communicate with that 8255 by a data bus or through a data bus, and communication between peripheral and microprocessor will start. If you want to read something from the input port, you need to initialize that input peripheral. Once it is initialized, you need to get the data from input device into a data register present in 8255, and microprocessor reads that data from that register only. Note, microprocessor doesn't read directly from the input device. Input device writes the data to be inputted in a data register of 8255 and microprocessor reads it from there. It is something like a hotel. In a hotel, there is a kitchen, and in that kitchen connecting to dining area, there is a window. Cook inside will create food whatsoever is ordered and put that food in a window, and a person outside that window in a dining area will pick that food and give it to the customer. So, if customer is a microprocessor and if customer is to get that input from a peripheral like cook inside, then there is a window required. Cook will not directly serve the food to you as a customer. It will be done so through a window, and that window is data register of 8255. Cook will cook some food, put it in that data register, and from there a waiter will pick up that food and give it to a customer, that is a microprocessor. On contrary, if it is output device, microprocessor will put the data in data register, and from the data register the output device will pick the data and show it to the user. So, input and output devices are not directly in touch with microprocessor, but it is indirect communication through a device called as a port, and ports are inside peripherals. Is it clear? So, that way port is to be operated. Now, once initialization is done, once the window the data register behavior is fixed, whether input or output, the move and in or out commands from microprocessor will see that data is going to the data register from microprocessor if it is output, or data is being picked up from that data register to the microprocessor if it is input data. And that is what program we need to write. So, writing peripheral program in short is only 3 to 4 lines one. It's not more than that. It's not very long. Only logic has to be clear. The circuit which we are writing program for should be clear. The functioning of input output devices should be known, and then only we can understand writing some piece of programs for initializing as well as for data transfer between microprocessor and I/O device. And these programs are 3-4 lines program only, not more. So, these smaller programs are written and they are executed onto our SDK kit, or they are compiled on a compiler or assembler on a PC, and then they are executed to check the result. There are two questions. We are trying to understand 8255, and as a standard method, we go ahead with understanding functionality of 8255, then understanding architecture of 8255 from inside, and then writing initialization programs or a data transfer programs for application purposes. One more thing needs to be studied for 8255, and that is how to create command words which will initialize that peripheral. So, let us start with architectural diagram of 8255. Remember, questions are directly asked.